Only the Word of God has the power to change the way that people think. Amen. It's the only way that will do it. We can condition people. We can keep people away from things. If just keeping people away from bad things, then prison would be a wonderful place. People would go to prison, they'd get away from whatever it is that they were doing, and when they got out, they wouldn't go right back to it, right? But what happens? They go right back to it. Why is that? Because all you did was keep them away from whatever the thing is that was dangerous. But unless you change the way that they think, you have to change the way that you think in order to bring true change in your life. Amen. How many of you got saved and baptized in the Holy Ghost at the same time? Nobody. Not one person. Okay. How many of you, what was the duration of time between the time that you got saved and then you got baptized in the Holy Spirit?
15 years.
20 years? So you got saved and then 20 years later you got baptized in the Holy Spirit. Good. Lee?
4 years.
4 years. That's good. That's good. 9 years? 15 years?
4 months.
4 months? Okay, we're getting closer. Steve?
Couple years? 5 years.
5 years?
Three.
Some of you, who is this Holy Ghost you keep talking about? No.
Mine is more like 10.
Yeah? Yeah? Anybody else? Chris? 12? 6? Was it here? You got baptized in the Holy Ghost here?
Yes,
cool. 12?
40
years. You went tarrying. That's that tarrying word we hear about in the Bible. I was tarrying for the Holy Ghost. How about in the back? Pansy? Several years? Amiro? Did they use Roman numerals back then? Gonzalito? Yeah. I'm going to continue just studying the book of Acts, but the more that I'm reading this, I just think it was supposed to be one event. I think the way that God intended it for it to be after reading it is that you get saved and you get baptized in the Holy Ghost at the same time. Amen? Do you think that the devil has been very good at peeling out the baptism of the Holy Spirit? I mean, he knew he couldn't beat salvation, but if he takes out the baptism, he takes out the power. You have the power for salvation, but it's the Holy Spirit that gives us the empowerment to live a holy life. You know what I mean? It's like trying to quit smoking or something. It's like you're trying to quit smoking on your own is just futile. I mean, have you ever tried to quit something? And you tried to do it on your own, and you tried the 10-step program, and you did all the things, but you know, it didn't happen. But once you got the power of the Holy Spirit in our lives, that truly is where the power comes from to live this life. I can't imagine trying to live a Christian life without the Holy Spirit would just be hard. I mean, because you're really having to will yourself into doing, you know, your flesh just sometimes doesn't want to do holy things, does it? Does it? Now, maybe when you're at your best, maybe when you're awake and you're fully fed and you're focused and you're there's no worry or anything. But when we get way tired, you ever seen what comes out of our mouths when we get really, really tired? I'm like, I have preached in here, gotten in the car and said some of the stupidest things I've ever said to my wife before because I was tired. I wasn't at my best. I wasn't able to keep my guard up. So the baptism of the Holy Spirit, see, the salvation comes in and the Holy Spirit comes into our hearts in salvation. Amen? That burns out all of the death so that life can come in. But so is the baptism of the Holy Spirit. It's another fire that comes into us, but it's like the fire of the temple that stayed lit all the time. It's the power. It's the burn. It's the one that's the abiding fire that stays in our hearts. So I was just curious. Did anybody have just a real far out wild experience getting baptized in the Holy Spirit? Tongues of cloven fire appear above your heads, loud sounds, anything like that? Nobody. It was just simple and subtle. Somebody came up, laid their hands on you, said, I baptize you in the Holy Spirit, and you began to speak with other tongues. Yes? No? What happened, Karen? Well, you've heard my mom's testimony, right? I mean, Brother Hagin, in a circle with Kenneth Hagin, finally at Lakewood, and he just jumped in and he touched her and boom. I mean, she just took off like there was no tomorrow. Amen? What is the experience supposed to... I mean, you hear of these other experiences, right? Have you heard of people? It's like the glory shone down and, you know, it's like they were in... And for a lot of us, it was just a very simple accepting of the baptism of the Holy Spirit, right? With the evidence of speaking in tongues. So, amen. I was just curious. I'm going to start back in the book of Acts, and we'll just go through a couple of verses. I'm not going to overdo it tonight. Amen. And I think when we stopped, I was in Acts chapter 2, verse 5. And this is right when the Holy Spirit fell. It says, now there was residing in Jerusalem Jews, devout and God-fearing men from every country under heaven. So what we talked about last time is that when the Holy Spirit, when it fell, it was a very, very well-publicized, well-witnessed event. Wouldn't you agree? I mean, this was not done in some back room of a little church with a couple of saints in the dark. Amen. The baptism of the Holy Spirit was done. It was done very, very openly. It was done on the day of Pentecost. And you remember that that was a feast that took place. It was 50 days after Passover. That's where we get the word Pentecost. It was a one-day feast because it was in the middle of harvest. How interesting that the Holy Spirit came in a time of harvest. Amen? That's a cue for us. And so all of a sudden on this day, when every good Jew had to be in Jerusalem for these great feasts, it was part of the law. And so all of a sudden God waits till there's the biggest possible crowd that he could get, and the Holy Spirit fell. And this to me is just one of the coolest parts, is that a lot of times, like only Jesus could hear what God said, and everybody else around them thought they heard like thunder or something. Remember that in the Bible? It's like those that knew God, knew his voice, they could hear what he was saying, but everybody else around them, it's kind of like when Paul got knocked off his donkey, you know, and he's having this conversation with Jesus, everybody else around him, they didn't hear that conversation. It was just between him and Jesus. But this, the baptism of the Holy Spirit, before it even starts, it's like this siren is getting wound up from heaven. And all of a sudden you hear this sound, and you hear this sound, and you hear this sound. And the only thing I could even liken it to would be one of these supersonic jets flying over your head at a very, very low altitude, but at the speed of light or at the speed of sound. I mean, it had such a sound. There was such an announcement to the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Isn't it neat? Jesus came into a manger surrounded by a few. The angels all worship. Baptism of the Holy Spirit, it was loud. It was noised about. And matter of fact, it was so loud and so noised about that it didn't just affect the 120 in the upper room. Everybody in the city came running. It happened at 9 o'clock in the morning. 9 o'clock in the morning, everybody hears this sound and they came running. And you had the most devout Jews, you had everybody that knew anything about the Levitical law and the Jews and the feast and Pentecost and all those things, and they came running. And all of a sudden they're hearing this sound and they come across this group of 120 and these disciples are all prophesying in the name of the Lord, but they're doing it in a different tongue. And now all of a sudden all these people that have come from all these different countries, they begin to hear, and this is important, every one of them started hearing the praises of God in their own dialect. The disciples weren't just sitting there talking with another going, Shama, 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 Shama. You know what I mean? When we pray in tongues, we are edifying, we are praising, and we are worshiping God. That's what we're doing. We are lifting up in an unknown tongue a message to God that He understands, that brings edification and just shines such a big light on how big God is. I don't think we really sometimes understand how powerful it is to pray in tongues. I mean, it really is one of our most super secret weapons that there are, is to pray in tongues. Amen? Now, and Steve's probably better apt at teaching this portion than I am, but there are certain pitfalls that we fall into sometimes in praying in tongues. We'll pray in tongues over here, and we'll try and do something over here. Shandarabasalaba, you know. We're trying to do left brain, right brain at the same time. But when we are praying in tongues, I want to encourage us that when you begin to pray in tongues over situations, speak as if you're speaking to that thing, but speak to it in tongues. So if I'm praying for Brother Jerry, I'm like, Shodraba Sandaraba. I am focused and I am speaking and I am praying in tongues on purpose. I am locked in. My spirit's locked in because when I'm praying in tongues, I'm praying out mysteries. Amen? And so when I'm praying, I want to do it. I want to keep my mind engaged, though. I don't want to fall into the habit of just mindlessly praying in tongues. It's a good thing to do. Trust me, it's better than other things you could be doing. But in order to focus it and to make sure that it comes out and that you're focusing it. And another good thing, you know, remember Paul said that I would prefer that you all prophesied? The same place where your tongues comes out, if you can locate that, when you begin to pray in tongues, can you locate where that's coming out of you? Yes or no? I want to encourage you. That's a good exercise for you to do. When you go home tonight or whatever, as you're praying in tongues, locate where out of your being that's coming from. Because out of that same place will come prophecy. Amen? It's okay to pray in tongues because I don't know what I'm saying, but then God wants us to interpret that sometimes. We want to edify everybody, so I want to begin to prophesy. Well, prophecy will come out of the same place that that tongues comes out of. And so now I'm not just edifying myself, I'm edifying everybody else in the room. Amen? So what happened on that day of Pentecost is that God did not hide, did not shy away. He dropped the bomb of the Holy Spirit, and it was for everybody to hear and everybody to sing. The outpouring was not relegated to a small, meager, insignificant group of religious nuts. Say amen.
Amen.
It was witnessed in the Capitol by the elite or the ruling class. There was nothing left to speculate. Verse 7. And it says, and they were besides themselves with amazement. And that word beside themselves means they were confused and they were thrown into confusion. Just as God did back in Genesis, when all of a sudden at the Tower of Babel, their language got confused. It says the people were confused. The people were confused when God's language left. They were also confused when God's language came back. Same word. They were confused. They did not know what was going on. Just as God confused their speech in Genesis when His language left, when His language returned, it confused the people. If it was only for the apostles, and I'm talking about the baptism of the Holy Spirit, or for a small period of time, why was it done on such a grand scale with such a global audience? If the baptism of the Holy Spirit was only supposed to be for the apostles, or was only supposed to be for a small group of people for a set amount of time, then why was it done on such a grand scale? Why was it done for every language was represented there? Amen? I mean, God, this was the biggest podcast of all time. And He did it in every different language so that it wouldn't just stay in Jerusalem. It was going to go back all over the world. Every one of those people in Jerusalem that day went back and became a witness for what they saw that day, and they could share it in their own tongue and dialect. And to prove it, they can say, I heard people, simple carpenters, simple fishermen. I saw people. These were not the elites that were doing this. The disciples, these were fishermen. These were workmen. That's like the construction workers going back home and leading revival because they heard their God being praised in their own tongue, and it witnessed to them. Verse 8, And it says, then how is it that we hear each of us in our own dialect to which we were born? The crowd understood the languages spoken. My next question was, did the 120 understand what they were saying? The group heard their languages, but did the disciples and the apostles, did they know what they were saying? I'd say probably not. I remember being in Pastor Tommy Levette's church. When we went there that few times, we would go to church, and this was in Crowley, Texas, a small church. And a guy that was a Bible school student, friend of mine, brought his sister. His sister was an unbeliever. He was a believer. And so we're in this really small, it was a really small church, and we're worshiping God. It's the middle of praise and worship, and I'm just praying in tongues, praying, la, la, la. Well, the end of the service, she comes back to me, and she goes, you were speaking perfect Latin. Latin. Because you know me, I'm a big Latin guy. You know, when I get up, I'm like, don't even know what Latin is. Like a food? Like what? Latin? Like what? But she knew Latin. I didn't know Latin, but she did. And so I became a witness to her standing behind her because she actually thought that I was doing it on purpose. I don't even know how to spell Latin, you know, and here I am, but it was perfect. She said, you were speaking perfect Latin. Has that ever happened to anybody else? That's good. Remember Pastor, who taught us the Holy Spirit when we were at Bible school? Pastor Shook. They would even go to the lengths of, okay, pray in tongues, and he would say, okay, now do it with a Russian accent. And do a Chinese or do Indian. And he actually would take you through different exercises where your prayer language would change with the dialect. It was very cool. We could do that one night. You want to have fun one night? That would be fun. So, Acts chapter 2, verse 14. It said, but Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed the crowd. This, to me, is one of the best testimonies and examples of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. If you look in the book of Mark, chapter 14, verses 66 through 72, Peter denies Jesus Christ three times. Amen? Peter, after they've gone to the Garden of Gethsemane, after Judas betrays Jesus, and Peter is following along to the religious leader's house to find out what they're going to do with Jesus. I mean, the flock has been scattered, and Peter, Jesus had prophesied before, said, Peter, before the cock crows, you're going to deny me three times. Well, Peter does it. And so here were my questions. Number one, was Peter a disciple? Yes? Did he spend time with Jesus every day? Was he with Jesus when he was transfigured? Yes. Let me just go ahead and jump to the end. All these are going to be yes. You don't have to hesitate. All right. Witnessed every miracle Jesus did? Yes. Confessed Jesus was the Son of God? Yes. So how is it that a man can walk with Jesus every day, see every miracle, be a part of a transfiguration, even experience the supernatural? I mean, Jesus is transfigured, and you got Moses and Elijah, and they're talking, and Peter's so freaked out, he starts talking about wanting to make buildings for everybody because we need to remember this day. This is a big thing, Lord. We need to build some tabernacles. We need to remember this. He was there when Jesus fed the thousands. He was there. He saw it all. He walked on water. But yet, it wasn't until the baptism of the Holy Spirit that Peter actually got the boldness. See, Peter denied Jesus in a small crowd by a fire. He cursed Jesus. He screamed. He cursed. He yelled at Jesus. He denied him. But then after the baptism of the Holy Spirit, Peter takes the lead. Peter's the first one to say anything after the baptism falls. The one who was the most scared and the one who was the most timid, is the first one out of the chute that stands up and begins to address a crowd of thousands. And he does it with a boldness, and he does it with just like a laser-like focus, and he begins to lay out the case for Jesus Christ being the Messiah. Peter became a witness that day. Amen? He had seen a lot of cool things that Jesus had done, but that day is when he truly became a witness for Jesus Christ. And he begins to preach Acts chapter 2, verse 17. And it says, "And it shall come to pass in the last days." So Peter begins to quote Joel chapter 2, verses 28 through 32. See, Joel prophesied many years ago that God at the appointed time would pour out his Spirit on all flesh. The only thing that Peter added to that prophecy was the word last days. Last days is not mentioned in the book of Joel. Peter adds that in the book of Acts, in the last days. Last days means from now until Jesus returns. So the Holy Spirit was never supposed just to be there for a few moments for a special group of people. Once the Holy Spirit fell, once God poured out his Spirit upon all flesh, that was setting up the last days. And those last days took place from that day of Pentecost all the way until the second coming. Amen? The Holy Spirit's never going to leave the earth. We don't want him to leave the earth, do we? He's the one that draws us. You know, when we pray for people, it's the Holy Spirit that goes and he draws people's hearts. How many of you remember that time in your life where you felt like the Holy Spirit was drawing you? Drawing you, drawing you, drawing you. Amen? Only the Holy Spirit can do it. Amen? When we pray for other people and when we forgive other people, we allow the Holy Spirit to step in. We get out of the way. The Holy Ghost comes in and he'll begin to draw people. So we never want the Holy Spirit to leave. Never, never, never. So he begins to prophesy that the baptism was going to be from Pentecost until the return of Jesus. In the book of Joel, the outpouring was for the spiritual and national leaders. Under the new covenant, it's to all flesh or whoever will receive it. Amen? The baptism of the Holy Spirit is for everyone. Do you have the power in your life? Do you sense that power in your life? When you begin to pray, when you begin to see different situations and things, you know, when you get into a situation and you don't know what to do, what do? We begin to pray in tongues. Amen. Lord, I need wisdom here, Father. I my mind knows what to do, but I need to know, what do you want me to do? And so when we spend quality times praying in other tongues, our spirit man, like that gyro, begins to move more and more and more, and our natural mind will begin to subside. And then all of a sudden, out of our spirit, we start hearing, okay, Holy Spirit, what is it that you want me to do? Amen? The gifts of the Spirit. How many of you have ever walked in the gifts of the Spirit? Come on, we've got three half-handed. Come on, what are the gifts? The gifts of the Spirit. Okay. Did I put you on the spot? Pardon me? Walked in the gifts of the Spirit. There's nine gifts of the Holy Spirit. Do you know what they are? Miracles? Work? Yep. Very good. Ding, 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 ding. Hey, we'll be married 20 years tomorrow. Woo! I married me a smart one. I went to that Bible school. I'm going to get that one that can count right there. I want that one. Now, we'll be married 20. We were talking about it because we were running around the day of our wedding looking for wedding music, I think. Remember that in Fort Worth? That was funny. 20 years. Isn't that crazy? So the gifts of the Spirit, amen? When we're baptized in the Holy Spirit, I believe that each one of us in our salvation pack also has the gifts of the Spirit, word of wisdom, word of knowledge, tongues, interpretation, healing, miracles, faith, those types of things. The gifts of the Spirit are for others. Amen? If I have the gift of, if I can, you know, word of wisdom or word of knowledge, I'm not going to give myself word of wisdom or word of knowledge. I'm going to be able to come up and say, you know, I just really think the Lord is saying thus, thus, and thus. And it's to edify the whole body. The working of miracles. You ever see Benny Hinn on TV? That is a perfect picture of the working of miracles. There are miracles, and it's happening on a large, large scale. Amen? So even the gifts of the Spirit, we are to be walking in the gifts of the Spirit. That's part that comes with us when we get baptized in the Holy Spirit, is we have now the access and the power to begin to walk in the gifts of the Spirit. As you walk in the gifts of the Spirit, you want to be raised also in the fruit of the Spirit. Nine gifts, nine fruit. Amen? Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such there is no law. If you're heavy in the fruit of the Spirit, you can be heavy in the gifts of the Spirit. Amen? They work hand in hand together. So it's just another thing for us to develop. So basically, Peter gets up. He's got a group of all of these Jewish people. They've heard the sound. They've heard them magnifying God in their own tongue. And he begins to do what every smart Jewish person would do. He goes back to the book of Joel. And he begins to quote the book of Joel because they understand what that means. Amen? All Peter does by the leading of the Holy Spirit is he starts pointing out the fulfillment of the prophecies. See, Joel said, he didn't come and say, oh, look what God just did. No, he goes back to the book of Joel and he said, in those days that I will pour out my Spirit on all flesh. He begins just to show them in the Scripture what God was going to do and shows the fulfillment of those prophecies. In Acts chapter 2, 19 through 21, it says that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Amen? That's why I'm just wondering, because he's talking about salvation now. That's why I gave you my first question. Do you think that salvation and the baptism of the Holy Spirit were supposed to be the same experience? Because we talked about the baptism of the Holy Spirit, but then Acts chapter 2, verses 19, he starts talking about the word salvation. It's the word sozo. It means to heal, preserve, to rescue. What that is saved or rescued from destruction and brought into divine safety. Do you think the salvation and the baptism were meant to be received at the same time? And I really think they were. I really think that they were supposed to receive Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior and be baptized in the Holy Spirit at the same time. See, Paul was a picture of what every Jewish person was supposed to be like. Paul, under the law, receives Christ as Messiah, is immediately baptized in the Holy Spirit, and immediately takes the message to the whole world. Notice how Paul first, Paul's missionary journeys, Paul's travels, all the different journeys, that's what Israel was supposed to look like with the baptism of the Holy Spirit. They were supposed to receive Jesus as Messiah, then they were supposed to in turn take that message and go to the world and to preach it with the power of the Holy Spirit. But they didn't. What happened? They turned inward. Amen. Everything turned inward. And it took the great dispersion to finally push everybody out and to get them out and doing what they're supposed to do. I like this in Acts chapter 2, verses 22 and 24. It says, "You men of Israel, listen to what I have to say. Jesus of Nazareth, a man accredited and pointed out and shown forth and commended and attested to you by God by the mighty works, the power of performing wonders and signs which God worked through him right in your midst, as yourselves know. This Jesus was delivered up according to this definite and fixed purpose." Peter stood up and declared openly and loudly that salvation, true freedom, peace, the one true Son of God who was raised from the dead, his Old Testament fulfillment to a Jewish person, is and was the Messiah. He took that opportunity of the baptism of the Holy Spirit to get up and very loudly and very publicly say, he would have gotten killed for that a day before, wouldn't he have? If Peter would have stood up and gone into the synagogue and started preaching Jesus as the Messiah, they would have picked up rocks and taken him to the outside of the town, and they would have stoned him for it. But once the baptism of the Holy Spirit fell, he stood up in power and in boldness, and he proclaimed publicly that Jesus Christ is the Messiah, because he tags it with, because he rose from the dead. And that's what every Jewish person was waiting to hear. They knew that Messiah had to be resurrected in order for him to be Messiah. See, the Holy Spirit's smarter than we are. Isn't that awesome? I mean, he knew exactly. If you don't know how to witness to somebody, if you'll just take a minute and pray in tongues, he will give you a strategy on how to unlock that person. He will. He will, if he will just, he gave Peter the combination. This is how you unlock this group of people. First, you go back to the book of Joel to the prophets, because this is what they hang everything on. Everything they believe is on the law and the prophets. And if you will go back and show them that Joel was prophesying and that it was fulfilled today on the day of Pentecost, and if you will go back and prove and show that Jesus is the Messiah, that he was raised from the dead, you will win them over and they will listen to what you say. They will change their opinion about Jesus. And that's exactly what the baptism of the Holy Spirit did. It changed their mind about who Jesus was. Isn't that awesome? In Acts chapter 2, verse 29 through 35, Peter goes back to the Old Testament and systematically lays the foundation as Jesus the Messiah. And he even goes back and he starts quoting David. Now, folks, when you start quoting Moses and David, that's old school. I mean, that's what these people lived for. If you could quote Moses or if it came from David, it was as if God had said it himself. That was the real deal. There was no other standard by which you would be measured. If Moses said it or David said it, it was gospel. And so Peter, under the baptism of the Holy Spirit, he begins to prophesy and to even quote exact references that both David and Joel had concerning Jesus and how he fulfilled every prophecy, the fulfillment of prophecy. Acts chapter 2, verse 36. It says, therefore, the outpouring of the Spirit is a sign that Jesus had been exalted to the right hand of the Father. Pentecost is a sign that Jesus is Lord. Just very quickly, just for an exercise, pray in tongues for a second out loud. Okay, stop. The reason that we can pray, the reason that you're praying in tongues is in direct correlation that we know that Jesus made it from earth to heaven. Because tongues couldn't come until Jesus was seated next to the Father. So every time that you pray in tongues, you are validating the fact that Jesus' body wasn't just moved or hidden, that it wasn't part of some religious game just because we wanted to say that Jesus was resurrected, but we couldn't prove it. When we pray in tongues, you're giving direct evidence that we know for a fact that Jesus left the earth and ascended and is seated next to the Father. Tongues couldn't come till Jesus left. That's how we know Jesus made it. God sent tongues so that we could verify it and we knew without a shadow of a doubt. Isn't that awesome? When you're praying in tongues, we are validating the fact that Jesus Christ was resurrected, was dead, buried, and resurrected, and is right now seated next to the Heavenly Father. Amen? Now let's ask the big question. Did Jesus ever pray in tongues? What do you think? Did he? Didn't he? I don't know. How many say yes? I say possibly. How many of you say no, emphatically? Do you want to talk about it? Why didn't he need it? Yeah, he had the Holy Spirit inside him. You're right. You're exactly right. Yeah, that's good. John, though, was also born, and he was baptized in the Holy Spirit, and he prayed in tongues, didn't he? He was baptized while he was in the womb. All right, here's my 2 cents. You want to hear my 2 cents? Just say yes, because I'm going to do it anyway, okay? All right, when Lazarus was in the grave, and they came and told him, your friend Lazarus is dead. And it says that Jesus began to groan with inarticulate words. He was grieved as he went to raise his friend from the dead. So I would speculate that very possibly Jesus could have been praying in tongues as he went to go raise up Lazarus from the dead. Amen? 4 days. It's the same words. If you go look at it, you got to look at it. You got to read it. You can't just shoot me down without reading it, okay? That's your homework. Go back and read that. I don't know exactly where it is in which translation, but just go back and read when Jesus went to raise Lazarus from the dead. Amen? And if I'm wrong, I'm wrong. But it could be. There's speculation there, right? So we couldn't pray in tongues until we know that Jesus had made it. In Acts 2, verse 37, it says, "Now when they heard this, they were pricked in their hearts and said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, Men and brethren, what shall we do?" This is a very interesting choice of words. It says they were cut to the heart. Peter stands up and he preaches the first sermon under the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Excuse me. He preaches it. He preaches it with conviction. He preaches it from the Old Testament, from the New Testament. He preaches it to the point where this group of people is now ready to make a decision. And that's how you know that you're really preaching well, is if you can preach people to the point of making a decision. So Peter, as the first evangelist, stands up and he preaches the first salvation message with the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And it says the people were cut to the heart. And that cut to the heart means to pierce all the way down. It means emotionally pierced through. It means psychologically pricked, emotionally stunned, to agitate violently. Have you ever been to that point? You ever had a revelation come to you like that, where it hit you like that? That word, cut to the heart, is the only place it's ever used is in Acts 2:37. It's the only place in the Bible that this wording is ever used. Peter was the first to use the word of God to renew the minds of the people and to bring transformation into their life. The only way to truly change is to change the way that they think. Only the word of God has the power to change the way that people think. Amen? It's the only way that will do it. We can condition people. We can keep people away from things. If just keeping people away from bad things, then prison would be a wonderful place. People would go to prison, they'd get away from whatever it is that they were doing, and when they got out, they wouldn't go right back to it, right? But what happens? They go right back to it. Why is that? Because all you did was keep them away from whatever the thing is that was dangerous. But unless you change the way that they think, you have to change the way that you think in order to bring true change in your life. That's why we try and fight some of these battles, and we try and fight them in our minds. And I even have to say that even prayer and fasting sometimes isn't even enough to bring the change that you want. It's a good part, but what we have to do is we have to renew our minds with the Word of God. We have to allow the power and the Word of God take those thoughts, clean those thoughts, change the way that they think so that we can truly begin to, we have to think differently. We have to start thinking like God, and the only way to do that is through His Word. Amen? Thank you, Lord. Well, I'm going to stop there. Yeah, that's right. 10 minutes early. Yeah, I want to be invited back. No, I can tell when it's... That's good stuff. I love the book. I love the power of the Holy Spirit. Where's the power? Isn't that what we need to be asking ourselves? Where is this power? Where's our power? Amen? Each one of us in this room has been empowered. We're all baptized with the Holy Spirit. Amen? And so I'm looking at what this group of men did and women did after the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and they set the world on fire with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And I think how I just want to end tonight is that we have that same power that's within us. Amen? Now, we have to live a holy life. I think trying to run around in the power of God without character or holiness, it's not going to work. Ask Samson how that worked. You can have all the anointing in the world, but if you don't have any character to go with it, you're going to have a short ministry. You're going to be one of those bright shooting stars that's here and then gone tomorrow. I want to be here for a long time. Amen? I love the abiding power of the Holy Spirit that helps just take us day by day, day by day. Lord, Holy Spirit, what is it you want me to do today? Holy Spirit, who is it you want me to talk to today? You know, and beginning to build that relationship with Him step by step, learning to hear His voice. I think if that's probably the biggest question we get as pastors, I don't know how to hear God's voice. But I'm amazed at how many people can hear the devil's voice. People can hear the devil, no problem at all. Well, the devil. Well, we're so keen to listening. If we would just learn to hear the voice of the Holy Spirit, the guiding, the nudging, the leading, the peace, and those types of things. You know, following the Holy Ghost can make you rich. Listening to the Holy Spirit in your financial decisions, is He going to lead you into wrong? Is He going to lead you into less? Wesley, in your business, is the Holy Spirit going to, is He going to prosper you, or is He going to try and take from you? He wants to prosper you. You're a good businessman, Wesley. Wesley's a good businessman. I've spent a lot of time with him recently. He's got that entrepreneur spirit on him. So I just want to encourage us. Amen. We got to use what God's given us. Amen? Amen. Let's stand up. Lord, we thank you for tonight. We thank you for the word. Thank you, Lord, for the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Father, I thank you for the power of God, the fire of God, that it's moving in us and to us and through us. Lord, we plead the blood of Jesus over us. And Lord, we thank you for a great week. We plead the blood over our pastors as they're being refreshed, Lord. Give them great wisdom. Give them great rest today, Lord. We love you, Jesus. Guide us, Holy Spirit. Lead us, Holy Spirit, in Jesus' name. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Love you. We'll see you Sunday. See, members go to church. Owners are the church. There's a big difference between going to church and being the church. Amen? Jesus did not die on the cross so that we could have just this pretty building and have our little club every Sunday morning. This is the spiritual gym that God sends us to on a Sunday morning so that we can be equipped and worked out so that we're now ready and equipped to go out into a world that desperately needs us.